Despite numerous warnings, the famished workers at the shipyard remained confident that USS Guitarro, the submarine they had just left behind while heading out for their lunch break, was nearly ready for deployment. But in another part of the submarine, preparations continued, with teams carrying out their tasks, dangerously unaware that the vessel was tipping out of balance. This submarine was meant to be a crucial line of defense, and the Navy was desperate to add her to their fleet. But by the time workers returned to the port, they were greeted by a sinking submarine, putting a million-dollar operation at risk. The events of May 15, 1969 were a highly preventable error, threatening a crucial naval weapon when it was needed the most. As the investigation that followed stated, quote, "The Guitarro should not have sunk." And yet, she did. The birth of a new naval dynasty. As the United States and the Soviet Union plunged into a Cold War, oceans began turning into invisible battlefields, with nuclear threats lurking just beneath the surface. The U.S. Navy knew that countering the growing Soviet threat required not just a bigger fleet, but a new breed of submarine altogether. One faster, stealthier, and more dangerous than anything seen before. Capable of withstanding the weight of a full-blown nuclear war. American engineers set to work, enhancing their existing Thresher and Primate-class designs, lengthening these submarines, fitting them with additional torpedo racks, and outfitting them with cutting-edge defensive systems, transforming them into some of the most advanced watercraft weapons of the time, the Sturgeon Class submarines. These fast attack submarines came in two configurations, the short-hull version, measuring 292 feet in length, and the long-hull variant, extending to 302 feet. When submerged, their displacement ranged from 3,640 to 4,640 tons. Powered by a single S-5W nuclear reactor, these submarines could reach up to 30 miles per hour. These powerful vessels were built to strike, eliminating threats before they could make a move. But their offensive capabilities weren't the only skill that set these naval machines aside. With unmatched stealth, Sturgeon-class subs could become powerful hunters that could protect America should global warfare explode at any moment. Some Sturgeon-class submarines were optimized with SEAL dry deck shelters, allowing them to transport special forces into enemy waters and compromised regions that other vessels couldn't reach. By the spring of 1969, the U.S. Navy had launched 21 of these short-hull Sturgeon-class subs, including USS Sturgeon, USS Queenfish, and USS Hammerhead, positioning them as a critical asset in a rapidly intensifying conflict. Among those new submarines was the construction of USS Guitarro, originally slated for commissioning the following year. A stern warning. USS Guitarro's journey began in the mid-1960s, with her construction being awarded to the Mare Island Naval Shipyard in Vallejo, California. Her build was no small undertaking. The construction process took nearly a year, with costs estimated to be over the $35 million mark, according to Navy records. It would take another 2.5 years for her to officially launch. By the time she hit the water, hopes were high for her commissioning to be fulfilled by 1970. But as construction progressed, chaos began to creep in at the shipyard. Construction teams, originally working towards clear goals, gradually began to work at cross purposes. Communication between various groups handling different sections of Guitarro was inconsistent. With his keen eye and leadership, Commander William G. Lang, Guitarro's prospective commanding officer, began to notice troubling signs in the vessel's construction. To him, it was clear accountability had slipped. In March 1969, he urged for control and responsibility for all shipyard operations to be centralized to avoid errors that could jeopardize Guitarro's commissioning date. Yet his warning fell on deaf ears. The shipyard representatives, secure in their workers' long-standing reputation, flat-out dismissed Lang's concerns, claiming they had, quote, "been building ships for a long time without the need for such a procedure." They then added that no one had been injured and nothing had been damaged in the construction. As such, the commander left the meeting unconvinced, with no other option but to trust the shipbuilders. The beginning of the end. On May 15, 1969, USS Guitarro was moored at Mare Island Naval Shipyard, undergoing final outfitting and testing. Nearly complete and awaiting calibration, she was close to joining the American fleet, but still needed a few final adjustments before commissioning. At 4 p.m., a team of nuclear construction crew, responsible for the systems related to the submarine's reactor, began their task. Positioned at the aft section, they carefully calibrated instruments by filling ballast tanks, adding just over 5 tons of water in slow, steady increments. Meanwhile, roughly 200 feet away at the forward end, a small group of non-nuclear crew, responsible for Guitarro's structural balance, started their own task. At 4:30 p.m., they began adjusting the trim, fine-tuning the submarine's balance to keep her level along her length by adding water to counteract a slight upward tilt in the bow, entirely unaware of the nuclear team's near-simultaneous work behind them. For hours, the two teams worked in isolation, each steadily adding water to opposite ends of the submarine. Through the rest of the afternoon and early evening, the boat quietly grew heavier, her balance shifting, neither team realizing the combined weight was pressing the submarine into an increasingly unstable posture. On shore, observers noticed the Sturgeon Class sub settling lower and lower in the water. Around 7 in the evening, an ever-vigilant Mare Island security guard warned the non-nuclear crew that the submarine was riding so low at the bow that waves from other passing ships were splashing into an open manhole on her forward deck. But despite this, and even a second warning half an hour later, no one working on Guitarro took action, and the water continued to seep inside. While things appeared to be going according to schedule for her timely commissioning, problems were brewing in front of their eyes. Something's wrong. At exactly 7:45 p.m., the exhausted and hungry non-nuclear workers, preparing for their well-deserved dinner break, halted the water intake to the forward ballast tanks and left 15 minutes later, completely unaware that the nuclear crew had just completed their calibration. Moments later, as the nuclear crew began draining the aft ballast tanks, one of them looked up, and at precisely 8:30 p.m., noticed something was very wrong. A sharp, unnatural tilt forward. At that same moment, the non-nuclear team returned from their break to a shocking sight. Guitarro was dipping dangerously at the bow, water now flooding through multiple open hatches at an alarming rate. Quickly, panic set in at Mare Island Yard as workers from every level scrambled to seal hatches and close watertight doors. But tangled lines and cables snaked through the openings, blocking any chance of containing the flooding. Seawater surged in, incessant and powerful, filling the submarine faster than they could fight it. But their efforts were futile. The tipping point had been crossed. At exactly 8:55 p.m., USS Guitarro sank at the pier, her bow completely swallowed by the muddy waters of Mare Island. In a profession steeped in tradition, and most importantly, superstition, where missing a champagne bottle swing at a christening is quite a dark omen, one can only imagine how Guitarro's officers and crew saw this disaster, a haunting sign for a submarine that hadn't yet touched the open seas. It didn't take long before whispers around the shipyard gave her a fitting nickname, the Mare Island Mud Puppy. Repairs and reprimands. Guitarro partially sank at the pier, settling into the mud with her bow submerged about 13 feet below the waterline. The flooding caused extensive damage, setting back her construction and commissioning by several months. With an estimated $15.2 to $21.85 million in repairs, about half her total cost, this massive human error led the House Committee on Armed Services to appoint 3 members to a special subcommittee to investigate this sinking. After reviewing all available records at Mare Island and gathering more than 600 pages of sworn testimony from workers at the site, the investigators issued their findings on June 30, 1969. They concluded that the immediate cause of the sinking was the negligence of a group of shipyard employees. Other key contributing factors included inadequate coordination of both ship construction activities and the assignment of specific responsibilities. However, the decision that stood out the most to the investigators was the risky choice to trim the boat by filling the ballast tanks with water rather than using concrete weights. According to an expert submariner, quote, "To put water into a main ballast tank to a person in submarines is, you don't do this unless you want to submerge, or unless it is a very deliberate, controlled evolution." Closing out the investigation, The document stated it plainly, quote, "The Guitarro should not have sunk. It was not overwhelmed by cataclysmic forces of nature, or an imperfection in design, or an inherent weakness in its hull. Rather, it was sent to the bottom by the action or inaction of certain construction workers, who either failed to recognize an actual or potential threat to the ship's safety, or assumed that it was not their responsibility." The committee also called for centralizing control and responsibility over all shipyard construction to prevent such a disaster from happening again. Thankfully, only 3 days later, USS Guitarro was refloated, and after a 32-month delay, the nuclear-powered submarine was back from the dead, and the Mare Island Mud Puppy was officially commissioned into the United States Navy in January 1970. Operational at last. In 1972, the Mare Island Mud Puppy was ready to leave her troubled past at port and prove herself worthy of the open seas, finally under the lead of the very man who tried to save her all those years ago, Commander William G. Lang. From the moment she sailed, Guitarro became a force to be reckoned with. Weekly training operations and fine-tuning of her systems honed her skills, pushing the vessel and her crew to meet the pressing demands of the Cold War. Her commander turned Guitarro from a troubled submarine to a powerful warship, earning her rightful place in the Navy's arsenal. A year into her commission, Guitarro joined the 7th Fleet in anti-submarine warfare, or ASW, exercises, operating with surface ships and submarines to develop protocols against Soviet threats lurking in the depths. Her reputation grew further as she participated in major exercises like the Valiant Heritage Campaign, a massive Cold War simulation involving over 41 ships, 200 aircraft, and 18,000 service members from five nations, culminating in a simulated attack on San Diego. The Sturgeon Class submarine proved unmatched in underwater maneuvers, slipping undetected through waters filled with enemy forces, each sonar ping a reminder of the real dangers posed by Soviet submarines. In October 1980, her capabilities were tested again during an underwater rescue simulation, as she served as a mother vessel for the deep submergence rescue vehicle Avalon, training her crew to respond to submarine accidents caused by technical failures or enemy attacks. But perhaps Guitarro's crowning achievement was her role in testing the Tomahawk missile system. This revolutionary long-range jet-powered weapon, designed for precision strikes, was destined to become one of the most powerful tools in modern warfare. Guitarro's successful launches marked her as one of the first Pacific Fleet submarines to fire the Tomahawk, securing these missiles into the Navy's arsenal. However, not everything was smooth sailing for Guitarro amid the intense drills and operations. In the mid-80s, while she prowled the depths in ASW missions across the Pacific Northwest, a sudden electrical discharge jolted through her systems, sparking a fire in the heart of the vessel. The battery suffered a major casualty, and with smoke thickening, the submarine crew members rushed to contain the blaze as the commander struggled to keep Guitarro afloat. With this, the submarine was forced to remain surfaced as she crawled back to Mare Island to undergo urgent repairs. The end is near. In May 1988, USS Guitarro became one of the first in United States Navy history to install and operate the Navstar GPS, an early version of the Global Positioning System that offered unprecedented precision in positioning and navigational accuracy, pushing the limits of what underwater vessels could achieve. As Guitarro continued her stealthy missions in the Pacific, the world on the surface was changing rapidly. With the Eastern Bloc crumbling and the Berlin Wall about to be torn down, in December 1989, United States President George H.W. Bush and Soviet Premier Mikhail Gorbachev announced the end of the Cold War, committing to ease tensions between their two nations, and most importantly, boosting cooperation between their feuding navies. Guitarro continued her usual operations, but on October 4, 1990, hosted a historic visit from Soviet General Mikhail Moiseev, American General Colin Powell, and Admiral Charles Larsen, a symbolic tour that her predecessors could never have imagined. Despite the world changing above, Guitarro continued her work, preparing for her last deployment in 1991. During this two-month operation, the submarine worked independently before returning to port for final evaluations before her scheduled deactivation in September. Unlike surface ships, submarines undergo a long inactivation process before decommissioning, involving defueling and equipment removal. During this time, there was a private ceremony where four of her former commanding officers joined past and present crew members to honor her service. Officially decommissioned in May 1992, she was disposed of through the Navy's submarine recycling program. By the end of her 20-year service with the United States, Guitarro received a Navy unit commendation, two meritorious unit commendations, and two Navy E ribbons. Whether contributing to the development of the now iconic Tomahawk missile, providing ASW services, or conducting missions that will forever remain among the mysteries of the deep oceans. As the Naval History and Heritage Command noted, while USS Guitarro's birth, quote, had earned her the sort of notoriety that most submarines shun, for the most part, her life in the silent service was one of quiet distinction.